All right, so we're going to start with singing a couple of songs. Once again, before we do that, let's go ahead and have a quick word of prayer. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you once again, Lord, for this day. Thank you so much for waking us all up and getting us here safely. We pray you continue to be with those that are on their way. And Lord, we pray that our hearts would be properly prepared for the messages you have in store for us throughout this day. I pray be with us as we sing now. May your angels join us in chorus. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I know there are probably a lot of things that you guys look forward to in life, right? Or like maybe there's an event or a vacation your family's going to take that you're just super excited about. And of all of those things, you could probably think of one thing. You're like, I can't wait to go here. I can't wait to go there. And yesterday we talked about going to heaven. But what comes before that is a beautiful, beautiful event in Jesus coming again. Amen. He promised to come back for us and he'll come back to take us home. And so join us as we sing hymn 213, Jesus is coming again. The trumpet and loud let it ring. Jesus is coming again. Hurry, ye pilgrims, be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming again. Proclaim it, ye plains, Jesus is coming again. Coming in glory, the Lamb that was slain. Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming again. Tell the vast wandering throng, Jesus is coming again. Tempest and whirlwinds, the anthem prolong, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus is coming again. Nations are angry, by this we do know, Jesus is coming again. Knowledge increases, men run to and fro, Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again, Jesus is coming.
Amen.
Jesus is coming again. And so we're going to go a couple of songs over and we're going to go to hymn number 208. And I love this song because before, I mean, you don't have to raise your hand, but before I used to be really, 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 really afraid of the dark. And so this song, There Will Be No Dark Valley, was a song that resonated with me a lot. And I was just like, wow, there's never going to be night because God is the light there in heaven. He's coming again. He's going to take us home to this place that's full of light, not only literally, but full of light spiritually. And so let's sing There Will Be No Dark Valley, hymn 208.
There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes to gather his his loved ones home. Together, his loved ones home. Together, his loved ones home. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes. Together, his loved ones home. There'll be no more sorrow when Jesus comes. There'll be no more sorrow when Jesus comes. But a glorious morrow when Jesus comes. To gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. There'll be no dark valley. His loved ones home. There'll be songs of greeting when Jesus comes. There'll be songs of greeting when Jesus comes. And a joyful meeting when Jesus comes. To gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. When Jesus comes to gather his loved ones home.
Amen, amen. So let's turn on over to hymn 448. We're going to sing, "Oh, When Shall I See Jesus?"
Shall I see Jesus and reign with him above, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning, and from the flowing fountain drink everlasting love, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. Oh, shall glory, for I shall mount above the skies when I hear the trumpet.
Stand and sing one more song. We're going to sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, hymn 469.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine. and the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arm. Lean on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread?
You may be seated.
Testing, testing. Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath. All right, it's a beautiful day today. What we're going to do is, let's just start with prayer before we start with our morning icebreaker. Dear Heavenly Father, it's a beautiful day to be here to worship you, and we invite your presence to be here with us. And at this time, as we're having Sabbath school, Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit to be our teacher and our guide. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So for those of you who were here last night, we did an icebreaker. We're going to do the same thing again. I'm going to ask the kids that are 1 to 5 years old to be right here in this group. 1 to 5. Let's do 5 to 10 right over here. 6 to 10. 6 to 10 over here. 11 through 13 up here. 11 to 13. 14 to 15 right here. 14 to 15. And then let's have 16 to 20s right here. 16 to 20s. All right. 16 to 20s. Right here is going to be 20s to 30s. 20s to 35 right here. 20 to 35. 35 to 45 right here. 35 to 45. 45 to 60. 45 to 60. And 60 and older over here. 60 and older over here, okay? All right? Okay, one thing, I'm sorry. I need Shanna and John, and Ellen. Shanna and John and Ellen in that corner over there. Shanna and Ellen and John, okay? I actually,
is this exile?
You're exiled. Okay, Shanna, and now, I need Brandon and Sarah. You guys are over in that corner by yourself. Okay? All right, Shayna, you're with that group. You guys are over there by yourself. All right, welcome Ted, good to have you. Brittany, if you do come in, you need to be with that group over there, okay? All right. This is very simple. One of the things about F5 is we're all about fellowship and getting to know each other. So in your team, I want you to pick one person who's a spokesperson, okay? Now what you're gonna do is, if you don't know each other, share your name and where you're from, okay? Share your name, so listen up really quickly. So here's the icebreaker. Share your name, where you're from. I want everyone to have something they could either on their phone or a piece of paper. And this is a very simple question. What are the 4 most oft-repeated commands in the Bible? Now, I know people find this challenging because they'll ask me all kinds of questions. It's just, what are the 4 most often repeated commands that God gives us in the Bible throughout the Old Testament and New Testament? And as a group, I want you to come up with what you think they are, okay? And I'm curious to see that within different age groups, what kind of answers that we get. Now, I want to ask you right now, don't look it up on Google. Because if you look it up online, it will tell you the answer, okay? So that totally defeats the purpose. So do not look up on your phones. Start. Go ahead right now, okay? 4 most oft-repeated commands in the Bible. Yes? It's in the Bible. Yep. Commanded from God. What is the 4 most often repeated commands in the Bible? All right. Yeah, let's have you go in your group. 16 right here. Perfect. All right. And you are, how old are you?
I'm in the PA group.
Okay, okay. We are doing an icebreaker. We want to welcome you to come in. And come on over this way. You look like you guys are probably in your 30s to 40s. Is that right? Okay. You're in this group right here. You guys can sit right here. Welcome. Welcome. All right. If there's a team that's ready, I'm going to have a team captain come on up here. Come on up here. All right, we got a young man that's come up here. Just for being the first one ready, we got a little prize for you. What do you want? You can have an F5 challenge hat or an F5 challenge beanie.
Hat.
All right. Okay, see, he learned from last night. He's a smart learner. He learned whoever comes up first. Oh, your dad got the water bottle? Oh, ship off the old block here. Okay. I'm going to grab the roving mic. I know I just had the roving mic somewhere. Thank you so much. Are we on? Okay. Name?
I'm Griffin, and the first one we thought was love one another.
Love one another.
And then do not fear.
Do not fear.
And then have faith in me.
Have faith in me. What's number fourth one?
I am with thee.
Say again?
I am with thee.
I'm with thee. Great answer, guys. Good job. Good job. You guys are representing the 10 to 12 crowd, right?
Yeah, 13.
10 to 13? Okay, who's next? You guys did really, really good, okay? Come on up. All right, what's your name?
Pedro.
Pedro, what did you guys come up with? Come on in the back. You guys, welcome in. Come on in.
The 60 to 20 group.
Okay.
I'm with, so first we have love your neighbor as your own.
Love your neighbor.
Keep my Sabbath.
Keep my Sabbath.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind.
Okay.
And then fear not.
And then what?
Fear not.
Fear not? Okay. Yeah. Excellent job. Okay. Next group. Are we? You guys are last. After Brand, and then
Brandon and Sarah will go second to last, okay? Come on up.
All right, what's your name?
Jamin, and we are representing the 35 to 40, I think.
Okay, all right.
All right, thanks for the clapping. Appreciate that. Number one is repent. Number two is follow me. Number three, no idol worship. And four, go spread the word.
Excellent. Good answers, you guys. Unfortunately, the kids,
at least they got one right, both the kids. But good try, though. Good try, okay? Honorable mention. Honorable mention. You still get. Let's clap. Give them a big clap. 35 to 45-year-old. For those who are just walking in, the icebreaker question is, what are the four most oft-repeated commands in the Bible, okay? They're broken into groups, and they're trying to figure this out, okay? What's your name?
Arlen.
Arlen. And what did your group come up with?
I'm the...
Love and obey.
Wonderful. 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 Good job. Let's have 60 and over crowd. Someone from the 60 and over crowd. Anyone representing? Chris, you come and represent the 60 and over crowd. All right. I want to look like Chris when I'm over 60. All right. Chris, how old are you?
60. No, I'm 44.
Looking good. He's still representing, okay?
Yeah,
okay,
they wanted me to represent.
Go ahead, Chris.
The first command. What's our first command?
Remember.
Yeah, right. Our first command, I think, was fear God. Okay. Second one was love your neighbor. Okay. Third one was Sabbath keeping. And the fourth one, not really a command, but prepare for the second coming.
Amen. Amen. Great answers. Great answers.
None of them are right, but good answers. Good answers. Okay. All right. What crowd do we have? Let's have, this is our last crowd before our F5. Come on up. Oh, you guys, everyone's gone, right? Now.
Let's have you guys come on up. Come on up, guys. One of you guys, who's the spokesperson? All right. Come on up here. Come on up here. Okay. And what is your name?
Julia.
Okay, Julia.
And the ones that we thought of was, do not worship idols, do not be afraid, keep the Sabbath, love the Lord your God.
Great job, great job. And they got one right. Okay, now I've saved our F5 team members for the end, okay? For a deliberate reason. I'm going to have Brandon and Sarah come on up here. Because we've already done this icebreaker before. So you would expect them to know, right? And sometimes what happens when you embarrass people, they don't forget, okay? So... what did you and your wife come up with?
Well, we have fear not.
Okay, that's right. That's
yes.
One of them.
Okay.
That's the most oft-repeated command in the Bible, is to fear not, or some form of be not afraid.
Why don't we just stop there?
Let's stop there? Okay. All right, good job. They got one. They got one out of four. Okay, who's the spokesperson here? All right, I have high expectations. These are my team members, and they travel with me, and they've heard a lot of my messages. So, you know, either... I'm recognizing that I must be a horrible, horrible presenter, since no one can remember these basic things.
It's because you're supposed to speak faster and keep us awake.
Okay. So,
give praise.
Give praise, okay.
Fear not.
Fear not.
Give thanksgiving.
Okay.
And rejoice.
All right, let's give them a hand. They got all four of them right. Okay.
We have an excellent note.
Okay. Excellent job. Who's your excellent note taker?
Shayna.
Shayna, good job, Shayna. Now, the thing is, Shayna has traveled with me on a number of trips, and so if they don't get this right, at this point, I'm ready to resign, okay? So you guys, I just want to reiterate this as we get into the message. The most oft-repeated command in the Bible is to fear not or be not afraid. Second and third is to praise God and give thanks, and the fourth one is to rejoice, to be happy. The most oft-repeated commands in the Bible are not prohibitions. It has nothing to do with sex, money. It has nothing to do with thou shalt not. It's all for our happiness. That's what God cares about. All right? Amen. On that note, we're going to jump into the presentation. If you guys will pull up the PowerPoint for me, please. It's the one, it's this one right here, titled Four Most Oft Repeated Commands. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just get going with the story. Has anyone heard the story of Vance Vanders? It was the winter of 1937, a 60-year-old black farmhand in Alabama met with a witch doctor in a cemetery at nighttime. They got into an altercation, a disagreement, and this voodoo witch doctor cast a curse on Vance Vanders and told him he was gonna die. And he took something that smelled very foul and waved it under his nose. Vance went home. How would you feel if someone said and told you that they just cast a spell on you, a curse, and you were going to die? He had trouble sleeping. He couldn't eat. He started getting sick. He started getting worse and worse. His wife was very concerned because his condition was not improving. And finally, she was able to take her husband to go see a doctor. And the doctor, Dr. Doherty, he did all kinds of tests. He thought maybe it's cancer, maybe it's some other disease, and everything turned out negative. Couldn't understand why this guy is deteriorating and falling apart. And as he continued to press Vance's wife, she finally confessed what had happened. And she told the doctor about this altercation in the cemetery. And this doctor is thinking, this is ridiculous. This is crazy. No, I'm sorry, it's not this one. This doesn't make any sense. But he could find no other explanation for why Vance was starting to die. And he's a very bright doctor. And this is a true story. So he thought about, how do I solve this problem? And he came up with an idea. He told the wife, I want you to bring all the family members to the hospital tomorrow. Bring all the close relatives. And when they had assembled in the hospital room where Vance was, you know what he told Vance? He says he went and met the witch doctor. He held him. He almost strangled him and told him, you need to tell me exactly what happened. And the witch doctor confessed that he had taken some lizard eggs and rubbed it on Vance's belly, and they had hatched in his stomach. Most of the lizard eggs had died, but one was still alive, and it was eating him from the inside out. And then the doctor gave him a medication that would make you throw up. Now, can you imagine, this guy hasn't eaten for a long time, and I don't know, he's probably throwing up. Maybe he's throwing up acids from his stomach. And as he's doing this, and he's throwing up into a pail, the wise doctor reached into his pocket, pulled out a little green lizard, and threw it into the bucket. And when he saw it, he was just amazed. Vance, he sees a lizard in there. And pretty soon, he fell asleep. And he slept for 12 hours. When he got up, guess what's the first thing he said when he got up? I'm hungry. He ate so much, the doctor was worried. The doctor was worried that his stomach would burst. This is not the right one. Let me jump to the right. That his stomach would burst. Vance went on to live healthy for another 10 years before he eventually passed away. Okay? I'm not advocating that what the doctor did was right. There's a point that I'm trying to make with this story, okay? Who was the better witch doctor? Okay? Sam Schumann, another true story. He was told that he had 3 months to live because they discovered a malignant tumor in his brain. 3 months later, sure enough, guess what happened to Sam Schumann? He died. And during an autopsy, they discovered that it wasn't a malignant tumor, it was a benign tumor. It wouldn't have killed him. But he was told. Here's another interesting story. This is a true story. A man got himself locked inside a freezer. He thought he was dying. In fact, he started writing letters to his family members. And in the letters he's writing, my fingers are starting to freeze. I can hardly write. The next day they discovered him in the freezer. He was dead. You can read up there, the freezer was not even plugged in. The coldest it got in there was only 50 degrees. Ellen White says something that's very fascinating. Many die from disease, the cause of which is wholly imaginary. What bothers me about the statement is she doesn't say that this has known to be happen or it can happen. She says, many. Like, this happens a lot. But look at what she also says. Courage, hope, faith, sympathy, love promote health and long life. I want to underscore the power of your mind. A psychiatrist said something very profound. We have power over what we believe, but what we believe has power over us. Think about that very carefully. I want to tell you about one of my favorite professional athletes. He's my favorite Ironman triathlete. It's Chris McCormack, two-time world champion Ironman. For those of you who don't know what an Ironman distance is, well, you guys may know because you guys live right here. And you used to have the Ironman races. For those who don't know, it's a 2.4-mile swim, then you bike 112 miles, and then you run 26.2 miles. And you got to complete it under 17 hours to be an Ironman. And he shows up in Hawaii for the Ironman World Championships, which is in October. And he comes and he says, I'm here to win. People didn't like that. See, when you're in triathlon racing, you want to be humble. And this guy's a game changer. He shows up, he goes, I'm here to win. Well, what else are you there to do if you're in the World Championships? You're there to win, aren't you? Are you there to come in last? Anyways, he goes on to win 2 World Championships. Someone in a Facebook group I was a part of with a bunch of triathlon people asked him about how he deals with pain. I want you to see how a world champion thinks. In an Ironman, it is not a matter of if, but a matter of when, before the pain arrives. He said, expect it. When it comes, he says, hello, pain, I've been expecting you. Then he smiles. This is his way of honoring the pain. All right, you're here. Let's buckle down and get the job done. Embrace the pain. It's all a part of the whole amazing experience. Embrace it, and it becomes a positive thing. Chris says the body is stupid. It will do whatever the mind tells it to do. And many times when I'm on a long, hard run, I just remind myself of what Chris says. The body is stupid. It'll do whatever the mind tells it to do. I share these stories to underscore, again, the power of our thought life and what we allow to enter into our minds. You know, the world tells us what you focus on becomes your reality. The Bible tells us something similar. What does it tell us? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Now, I was asked to speak for Guam Adventist Academy and do a short little devotional, like a 15-minute devotional. And so I was sharing just a part of this message, not this complete message I'm sharing with you guys. And the athletic director for the Guam school, which is like, it's a small academy in Guam. She sent me these texts. I'm at a cross-country meet, and we are racing a top-notch school, and the team was talking about your sermon right before they started. Notice the date. It's November 4. She goes, they lost 25-31, but this was the second team, and they were competitive. They talked about your sermon even after the race. So they're thinking about the things that I had told them. Look at the date now. It's 6 days later. The middle school cross-country team was talking about your chapel yesterday. 6 days later, these kids are talking about the point of this message. Watch this. We are a school of 33 kids. That's not a very big school. The other schools have 1,000 plus, and with one school, just under 800 students. Both the boys and girls team came in first place. Could you imagine 33 students compared to schools with thousands? Expect the pain. Can you imagine that? It's the power of your thought life. Henry Ford, he said a famous quote, whether you think you can, you think you can, or you think you can't, you're right. Okay? The mind is powerful. It should be no surprise that God, who created us, he dedicated an entire book of the Bible, of which the theme is the mind. Which book in the Bible is a theme all about the mind? Anybody? Ecclesiastes is a great one. That one, the theme of Ecclesiastes is purpose. Proverbs, the theme of Proverbs is wisdom. I'm sorry? Who said that? Come on up here. No, I want to give you a prize. I want to give you a prize. Okay. Good job. Great job. Philippians. Think of all the verses you know in the Bible that come from Philippians. Philippians 2:5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Philippians 3:13, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forward to those things which are ahead. Philippians 4:6, be anxious for nothing. Philippians 4:8, whatsoever you think, think on these things, right? Whatever is true, just, pure, lovely, honest, of good report. If there be any praise, if there be any, think on these things. Philippians 4:13, I can do what? All things through Christ. God understands how powerful the mind is. What are you filling your minds with? Are you focusing on things that are positive and uplifting? Or are you filling your mind with things that are negative? Things that are toxic? I want to ask you, are you negative? Are you critical and judgmental? Are you always looking at other people and judging them? Are you always comparing yourself with others? Do you constantly ruminate? Do you self-loathe, constantly tell yourself that you are not good enough? That no one cares about you? Do you worry and stress all the time? Nothing in this world can torment you as much as your own thoughts. And you know what? Satan knows this. This is a special target of his attacks. The mind is the control center for the entire body. When two countries are at war, do you know who you want to attack? You want to attack the control center. Because if you can immobilize the control center, you can completely paralyze and totally disengage everything your enemy is trying to do. And Satan knows this. Do you know what one of Satan's most often used methods for hijacking our minds? Anybody? He uses all those things, but I believe it's through the use of fear. Do you know why I believe it's through the use of fear? By virtue of the fact that it's the most oft repeated command in the Bible. That the fact that God tells us this command over and over, do not fear, do not be afraid, be anxious for nothing, tells us that God knew that Satan would use this. Christian psychiatrists Frank Minerth and Paul Meyer say that anxiety is the most common mental disorder they encounter at their network of clinics across the country. So is it any surprise that God repeats this command more than any other command? Do you know we're only born with two fears? You're only born with the fear of falling and the fear of loud noises. Every other fear is learned. I'm a dentist. I've been doing this for 22 years. A lot of people are afraid of the dentist. Anyone here afraid of the dentist? You're not born with this fear. I get 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds coming in. They have no fear of the dentist. Do you know where kids get this fear of the dentist? That's right, from their parents. You. When you tell your kids, if you don't do this or you don't brush your teeth, I'm going to take you to a dentist and he's going to pull on your teeth. Or you're afraid of the dentist and you transmit that to your kids. Fears are learned. A simple and useful definition of fear is an anxious feeling caused by our anticipation of some imagined event or experience. It's imagined. Psychology Today puts it best in their January 1, 2020 article, Why Every One of Your Fears is a Lie. They're fears that we are bought into. Sam Schumann, the guy who got himself locked in that fridge. Vance Vanders, what did they believe? They believed a lie. A recent study went on to show that about 9 out of 10 worries are false alarms. Who here is a worrywart? You don't have to raise your hand. Who here incessantly worries? I can just tell by the expressions on your face, I can already tell who are the ones who worry a lot. Constantly worrying, and if you look back, you know what? Most of those worries don't even come to fruition. That's a lot of emotional energy you're wasting. I see it all the time with my patients, just worry and worry and worry. Do you want to worry like that? The acronym for fear, does anyone know what the acronym for fear is?
Forget everything and run.
Forget everything and run. That's a good one. I like that one too. There's a lot of acronyms for fear. The most commonly known one is false evidence appearing real. What is the lawyer here? What's the false evidence? It's a lie.
It's a lie.
Right? Now, we know that fear does not come from God. How do we know that? What verse in the Bible would tell us that fear does not come from God? 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and of a sound what?
Mind.
You see what God wants to give you? He wants to give you a sound mind, power and love. It is Satan who wants us to have fear. So, because God cares for our happiness, He gives us the perfect defense and offense to counter Satan's devices and to overcome his attacks. And they're found right in our icebreaker, in the 4 most oft-repeated commands in the Bible. What was the first one? Fear not. 2 and 3? Give praise and give thanks. And number 4? Rejoice, which is to be happy. Satan wants the exact opposite. What's the opposite of fear not? Fear, worry, stress, anxiety. What's the opposite of giving praise and thanksgiving? Complaining and murmuring. Who here is a complainer and a murmurer? You're a bunch of liars here. Thank you. We have one honest person back there. Okay? All right? Because you're all guilty of complaining and murmuring. All right? And I don't even know you, and I know this. All right? Now, and the last one is to rejoice. God wants us to rejoice. What does Satan want us to do? What would be the opposite of rejoice, being happy? Being hopeless. Being depressed. Do we see an epidemic of anxiety and depression across the country today? Now, this is what science tells us. How complaining physically rewires your brain for negativity, anxiety, and depression. Satan's brilliant because what he's doing, it's working. And God has given us the total solution and remedy. I want you to raise your hand. Don't just blurt this out, okay? I want to ask anyone under 20, what was the title of last night's message? Anybody? Yes. Come on up. Good job. We had one person who could remember the title of last night's message. We still have hope, folks. We have hope. Your name is Hope. Wow. Praise the Lord. You pick a pick. What do you want? Beanie or you want? Okay, there you go. Awesome. The title of last night's message was, If It Is To Be, It Is Up To Me. It was all about choices. The choice is up to you and I. It's up to you and I. Do you want to harbor fear? Do you want to follow God's commandments? Or do you want to fall right into Satan's traps? It was a few years ago. It was a day or two after Christmas. I got a phone call from my office. When I get a phone call from my office in the morning, it's never good news. They never call me to say, we just want to wish you a great day. There's always a problem. Someone's sick, something happened. I'm pretty sure I was in bed having my devotions when I got the phone call. They told me that a pipe had broken and there was water damage. If you haven't experienced water damage in your life, it's because you're just not old enough. Because if you're old enough, you will experience water damage in your life. It's like death and taxes. It's part of life. I've experienced water damage probably 2-3 times, so I know exactly what to do. You shot back up the water, you lift up the carpet, get commercial fans, and start blowing it out. And I told my staff, only cancel the patients for the morning. Don't cancel the afternoon patients, because I got to see my patients. And they said, it's not that kind of a water damage. It's extensive. And I'm like, okay, I'll come to the office. I get online, and I look on Yelp to find out who are the best mitigators. These are people who deal with water damage. Found a company, they call me right back, and I said, we'll meet you at the office. And my office is 30 minutes away, so I'm driving to my office. Now, what would be the natural thing going through my mind? What do you think would be the natural thing going through my mind? How expensive is this going to be? Money. What's it going to cost me? How long am I going to be out? The natural thing is to start worrying. By virtue of the fact that do not fear is the number one command given in the Bible, do you know that when you fear, you're actually disobeying God? And I want you to remember that, because when I start to have fears arise, I remind myself, I don't want to disobey God. Do any of you guys lie? Maybe. What's that? We try not to, right? We know that. We're not supposed to lie. We know there's certain things we don't do, okay? We don't kill people, right? But yet, you know, it's amazing how many people will be fearful and afraid and not recognize this is a command by God. So I had two things on my mind as I'm driving to the office. Can anyone guess what was on my mind? I'm not going to ask this group because they've already heard this. Who can guess what was on my mind as I'm driving to the office? Patience. My patience? Okay, that's a good answer. Anyone else? What's the worst possible thing? Money? Anyone else? Okay, don't worry. Don't worry. Whenever I ask this question, no one gets the answer right. Okay? No one gets the answer right. The only person who ever got the answer right was my twin brother, who was in the audience. Okay? Yes? How's God going to fix it? That's a great answer. That's a great answer, okay? All I'm thinking is, no matter what happens, I'm going to praise and thank God. Amen. I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm going to praise and thank Him. Because that's the number two and number three most important command in the Bible. See, the thing is, you have to be established ahead of time what you're going to do. Because in life, there comes tests. And tests come in the form of opportunities and trials. And if you're not established, you don't know what you might do. And we know what the four often most repeated commands are. So I was determined, in my mind, I was going to follow God's commands. There was a woman, she walked into, this is a parable, she walked into a swanky hotel. She got into the elevator, and there was a distinguished gentleman standing there in the elevator. And as they were going up, he said to her, "Would you stay the night with me for $1 million? What would you do? That's a lot of money. $1 million? You may never have to work again in your life." And after she caught her breath, she agreed. How could you not? For $1 million. As they were going up the elevator, he said to her, "Would you stay with me for $100,000? It's not $1 million, but isn't that still a lot of money? It's more money than most people make in 1 year. And right now she's thinking dollar bills. So she agreed. And as they were going up, he said to her, "Would you stay the night with me for $10,000? It's starting to get insulting now. But isn't $10,000 a lot of money, yes or no? It's more money than most people make in a month. You could go buy a small car for $10,000. So she stammered, "Yes." As they were almost to the top, to the penthouse, he said, "Would you stay with me for $500? At this point, she is, yeah, right? She is offended and insulted. And she says to the man, "What kind of a woman do you think I am?" To which he replied, "We've already established that." You understand the point that I'm making? You want to be established ahead of time. The tests don't help you to grow. The tests only determine where you are already at. It's the homework and the quizzes along the way that help you to grow. So I was determined in my mind, I get to the office, every square inch of that office was flooded. You can see the carpet bubbling up. This happened a day or two. I'm here at the office a day or two after Christmas. We had been gone for 5 days. I don't know if this happened the night before, or I don't know if this happened 5 days ago. Now, my neighbor's office got flooded. Well, it didn't get flooded, it had water damage. He's Indian, he's Hindi, he's my friend. If your water pipe breaks while you're at the office, it's very easy to fix. You just turn off the water valve, mop it up, and you're done. That happened while he was in his office. Why did God allow this to happen to me? I'm an elder in the church, a board member, I teach Sabbath school, I do volunteer ministry, I pay my tithe, I keep my Sabbath. Why is God allowing this to happen to me? To test me. Now, let me ask you a question. Now, as soon as I got there, the mitigators were there, and you know what they told me? It would be 2 weeks just to clean up the water damage. They said it would be 2 months before I can get back into working and see my patients. I've got patients to see. I've got staff to take care of. I've got bills to pay. I've got needy people to feed, two of them, my kids. Why is God allowing this to happen to me? How am I going to pay my bills? And every time I get bad news, you know what I'd say? Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Because the bad news would feel sometimes like getting kicked in the stomach. Thank you, Jesus. But let me ask you this. Could God have stopped this if he wanted to, yes or no? You sure? You're totally sure? Okay. Would it have been hard for God to stop this? You're saying it would be easy? Would God even have to do it himself? Could he just send an angel to put their finger on it? Yes? You believe that. So I have two options. One is I can complain and murmur, or I can choose to trust and praise God regardless of my circumstances. Okay? And I chose to praise him and thank him, even though I can't see why God would allow this to happen. We're told our Heavenly Father measures and weighs every trial before he permits it to come upon the believer. He considers the circumstances and the strength of the one who is to stand under the proving and test of God. And he never permits the temptations to be greater than the capacity of resistance. I love this quote. God will measure and weigh every trial before he lets it come upon you. And if he lets you come upon it, it's because he trusts that you can handle it. Romans 8:28 tells us, "What all things work together for good to them who love the Lord and who are called according to his purpose." So I'm going to choose to trust him. Now, one of the things that I always try to instill in my team members is a phrase, it could always be worse. No matter what your situation is, it could always be worse. The building could have burned down. My child could have cancer and dying. The worst thing I can imagine for a parent is if your child is kidnapped. To me, that would be the worst thing. So no matter what your situation, it could always be worse. In 2017, Denmark was the happiest country. Every year they will award a country as the happiest country. And Denmark was the happiest country, and it's a cold country. They have harsh winters. And why are the Danish so happy? This is their default mindset, that no matter what the situation, it could always be worse. So I want you to adopt this because it's an attitude of gratitude. Aaron Ralston, some of you may know his story. He was hiking in Utah. His arm got stuck as a rock fell. He was stuck. He cut his arm off to survive, and he came out. He has a movie about his life. Claire Champagne was in a reality TV show game. She shot a watermelon. It flung back, and this 5-pound watermelon smashed her in the face. Another gal was bungee jumping in Africa. The bungee cord broke, and she fell into a river in Zimbabwe. She broke her collarbone. It was full of crocodiles. She barely made it out of there. When they asked these three people and others that went through harrowing situations about their experience, they all said the exact same thing. You know what they all said? It could always be worse. All right? So I want you to adopt this mindset. So you know what? If you don't like your weekend presenter, just remember, it could always be worse. Okay? I mean that. So by the next day, they'd already pulled all the insulation out from underneath because it was soaking wet. Within probably 2 days, look at this, they'd already removed everything. I had to remove everything out of that office. Why is God allowing this to happen to me? Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Too often we grieve the heart of Jesus by our unbelief. That's our lack of faith. You know, faith is the opposite of fear. If fear is believing in lies, faith is what? Believing in Jesus. There's over 27 acronyms for the word faith. A few of my favorites: Father, all in thy hands. Forsaking all, I trust him. Food, always in this house. I like that one. You know, food is the word of God. Trusting in the word of God. My favorite one, fantastic adventures in trusting him. But too often we allow, we grieve the heart of Jesus by our unbelief. Our faith is short-sighted, and we allow trials to bring out our inherited and cultivated tendencies to wrong. It's talking about crucibles. That's what the Sabbath school lesson is for the last few weeks, right? Crucibles. When brought into straight circumstances, that means difficulties, we dishonor God by murmuring and complaining. When you look at the children of Israel, you know what? God led them. He parted the waters for them. He fought for them. He led them with a pillar of cloud by night, fire by day. But you know what? Nevertheless, when the spies saw the walled cities in the promised land, they allowed unbelief to enter their hearts and returned to the congregation with a faithless report. Lack of faith. They were fearful. By the words they spoke, they leavened the minds of the people with unbelief. With what? With lies. The record tells us what effect their murmuring had. The murmurings of the children of Israel were unreasonable. And the unreasonable always go to extremes. They uttered falsehoods. What are falsehoods? Lies again. Are you guys seeing the connection? Where there's faith, there's trust. Where there's fear, there's lies. It's saying they had no bread nor water. Is that true? They had no bread or water, or did God always provide for them? They had both given them by a miracle of God's mercy to punish them for their ingratitude and complaining. Against God, the Lord permitted fiery serpents to bite them. Do you guys see how offensive this murmuring and complaining is? That's the reason why God allowed the serpents to bite them. Why is this so offensive to God, murmuring and complaining? Does anyone know? God gives us promises, and he shows us that he's going to take care of us over and over. And when you murmur and complain, do you know what you're telling God? I don't trust you. When you tell someone you don't trust them, do you know what you're calling them? A liar. Have you been called a liar before? I have. It's very, very offensive. So now you guys know how your parents feel when you guys complain and murmur. You know what I mean? They clothe you, they feed you, provide air conditioning, pay all the bills. And then you're complaining, and you're telling your parents, I don't trust you. Okay? You want to score points with your parents? Tell them thank you. While I'm on that note, my daughters have a lot of their high school friends who come by my house. And you know what? There are two things high school students don't know how to do these days anymore. It's so easy to score points with parents. You walk into someone's house and just say, "Hello, Mr. Kim. Hello, Mrs. Kim." And all of a sudden, you're going to be in a 5% of kids that are above all the other kids just by saying hello. Okay? And then learn to say thank you. I will take these kids and I'll take them mountain biking. I take them places. I buy them stuff to eat. They don't even know how to say thank you. And so I'm debating whether to talk with their parents about it. It's pretty sad. You know what I mean? You would think it's pretty basic. Now, I will say this, with my patients, the Mennonite kids are the best kids, period. And then the homeschool kids and the kids who come from military homes are the best kids. They know how to say thank you. But this is a real problem today. But anyways, back to the sermon. Where did murmuring and complaining originate? That's right. Heaven. It started in heaven. Satan goes around insinuating, tending to cause doubt and distrust. And we're told dissatisfaction is contagious. It's fun to complain and murmur, though, isn't it? People do it because it makes you feel good, temporarily. It's toxic for you, but people like to do that, right? Someone starts complaining, everyone chimes in, and everyone is murmuring and complaining together. What is the opposite of murmuring and complaining, everybody?
Rejoicing.
Praise and thanksgiving and rejoicing, okay? Now, look at this. It says here, this victory, instead of inspiring gratitude and leading the people to feel their dependence upon God, see, when you are grateful and thankful, it leads you to be dependent on God. Gratitude and praise is faith in action. Those are the words from the Sabbath school lesson from about 2 weeks ago. Praise is the vehicle of faith by which we enter into the power and presence of God. See, when you have COVID, you have symptoms, right? Coughing, fever, numbness of your tongue or taste, and all these different things. When you have lack of faith, it also has symptoms. The physical manifestation is complaining and murmuring. But when you have faith, you know how it extends itself, externally manifests itself? Through praise and thanksgiving. Two times to be thankful. Do you know what they are? When you feel like it, and when you don't. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Two times to praise the Lord. What is it? When you feel like it and when you don't. Thank you. Thank you, John. You know what's interesting? When I ask this question, usually people just sit there and they have no clue. You know, I would think people would make the connection, right? But I find this happen a lot. From the rising of the sun to the setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. You know, the Bible tells us this verse, and everything give thanks. Is this challenging for some of you? I mean, this world is painful. There are a lot of ugly things that happen. There are children who are getting hurt, women who are getting abused and beat up by evil men. How can we give thanks for everything? Listen to this promise. Sister White tells us, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." This command, it's what did I tell you? It's a command, right? I didn't make it up. People go, "Well, are those really commands?" They're commands. When God says give thanks, this command is an assurance. That means promise. That even the things which appear to be against us will work for our good. God would not bid us be thankful for that which would do us harm. So if you're willing to trust him no matter what the circumstances, will you praise and thank him regardless? It's showing him that you trust him. Blessings and challenges. One of the offices near my office across the parking lot happened to be vacant. I was able to move all my stuff into an adjacent vacant office space. Praise the Lord. Could you imagine if I had to put all that into a storage center? Okay? So every time there was good news, praise the Lord. When the water company for drinking water, they go, "You know, we'll just put your whole account on hold. We won't charge you." Praise the Lord. Every time there was bad news, praise the Lord. A couple of the dentists in the my neighbors, they said, "You know what? You can see your patients at our office. I don't see patients on Monday. You can see your patients on Monday." I was like, "Thank you so much. Praise the Lord. But what am I going to do seeing my patients for one day?" But my landlord, who's a dentist, who's right across my office in the back, he goes, "I only work Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. You can see your patients on Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday." Praise the Lord. I'm not going to work on Sabbath, but now I can see my patients on Friday, Sunday, and Monday. 3 days. And God provided for all of our needs all along the way. How to lose the blessings of the trial. If you're going to get anything I want you to remember this one thing. Thus God desired to teach them a lesson of trust, but they murmured and complained, crying out in distrust, "What shall we drink?" Do we not too often, like the Israelites, forget God and by murmuring and complaining lose the blessing of the trial? This tells us that when God sends a trial or a test, he has blessings in store for you. How many of you guys have missed the blessings that God had in store for you because you were complaining and you didn't trust him? I shudder to think, because I used to be a murmurer and a complainer. The landlord's office manager sent me this text. I spoke with our claims adjuster again. He's adamant that we have no liability. He said that regardless if there was or wasn't intent involved, that the lease is specific about responsibility. He also stated that per the lease, if your insurance refuses to pay, that you are still accountable for the repairs. I hope your insurance company comes through for you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Marcy. I had $120,000 coverage for my office in case something like this happened to cover my equipment and supplies. I don't have coverage for the building. I didn't know that the lease was written in a certain way that I'm responsible for all the damage to the building as well. My brother-in-law, who's a businessman, I asked him, he said, yeah, leases are often written this way. So now I'm responsible for all the damage to that building. Praise the Lord, it didn't burn down. Now I might be responsible for $600,000 or whatever. I'm only responsible for $100,000. What's the worst thing that could happen? I'm going to have to get a loan for $100,000. Is it the end of the world? No. Praise the Lord. One of my friends messaged me. He asked me if I could help a missionary from Albania for him to come all the way to her office, and this is funny, Denise Beatty's name is on here. Ha! My friend Tom is a dentist in Spokane, and for her to drive all the way there would be 5 to 6 hours. And my office is closer. And as my friend asked me this, the first thought that came to my mind is, you know, I really enjoy helping people, but right now is not the best time. I'm trying to cram all my patients into 3 days worth of work. If there was a time, this is not it. That's the first thought that came into my mind, and then a story came into my mind. Does anyone know what story came into my mind? We talked about it last night. The widow of Zarephath. If anyone had an excuse not to help somebody, it would be the widow of Zarephath. And quickly, I was like, I repented of my decision. I said, I'd be glad to help. And this was a lesson God was teaching me, that anyone can help people when it's easy and convenient, but are we willing to help people when it's not the most convenient? Because see, during a trial, when you're going through a trial and you're going through difficulty, you have a lot of time to think. And one of my things is, Lord, help me to learn my lessons quickly, whatever it is. Because the Israelites, they didn't learn their lessons quickly. So you know how long they paid for? 40 years in the wilderness. I don't want to be in the wilderness for 40 years. I only want to be in this wilderness for 2 months. It wasn't 2 months. It was almost 6 months before I got back to my office. So the blessing of the trial. My insurance agent called me out of the blue, and he goes, did you know that you have double coverage? I said, no, why would I have double coverage? He let me know the insurance company wasn't happy, that somehow I had a double policy. Instead of having a $120,000 policy, I had a $240,000 policy. How many of you guys get double coverage for your homeowner's insurance or your car insurance? I didn't sign up for two. This was unbelievable. Now, I hate when people tell stories like God paid for my school loans and my school bill and they never tell you how it happened. I hate that. Well, tell me how it happened. I want to know. So I'm going to give you my best guess. A month and a half before the flooding happened, I got a bill to my office, Olympia Family Dental. I don't look at bills. My office manager takes care of all that stuff. But for some reason, I actually opened up the bill, and I actually perused through it, which I don't normally do that. And inside the bill, the physical address was this address in Chehalis, which is my previous dental office that I had sold over a year ago. When I saw that, I was like, I know how insurance companies work. It's all about money for them. They'll get you on a technicality. So I called them. I'm like, you got the wrong address on there. And they switched it. My only explanation is this was a bill for the other office. See, when you sell an office, you cut off all the ties, cut off all the bills, expenses. But you know what? Somehow I received this bill and I paid it. See, God knew that this flood was going to happen before the flood, did he? You know, God knew about this a million years before it happened. He had already prepared everything. As a result, the whole thing ended up costing $220,000. It's like God gave me a check for $100,000. Handed me a check. My office was outdated. I needed a remodel. I got a complete remodel for free. new carpet, new paint. See all these cabinets? All brand new, paid by Allstate Insurance. I got $50,000 worth of dental equipment free. You cannot outgive God. I'm like, God, you are so amazing. What if I had murmured and complained the entire time? I don't know what would have happened. I shudder to think. But you know what? Is it possible that I could have had to get a $100,000 loan? It's possible, right? But I'd like to think that regardless of what happened, that I would have kept praising and thanking God. Look at Joseph. One bad thing after another, and what does he do? You never see him murmur and complain, ever. He passed every single test, and as a result, what happens? Number two in command of Egypt. I want you to remember, because so many people are missing out on the blessings of God because they're complaining all the time. I'll just throw this one in there for you. I needed to pick up a truck for my dad. Right during COVID, truck prices just skyrocketed. My budget was like, I'll spend $15,000, $20,000 for a truck. Now I'm looking at $30,000 for a used truck. I found a truck. It was 2007. I wanted diesel. It was not diesel. It had 140,000, 50,000 miles on it, but I could tell it was very well maintained. It wasn't what I wanted, but it was the best thing I could find, and the guy wanted like $15,000 or $14,000. It's like, okay, let's just buy this truck. It was Friday night. We were negotiating, but it was going to be Sunday, and I said, you know what? I'll come by on Sunday. And he goes, well, do you want to put money down? I said, well, I didn't really have time. We'll just come by on Sunday, and I understand that it could be sold by Sunday morning. Sunday morning, guess what? Already sold. And my brother called. He sounded a little disappointed. I said, nah, just praise and trust God. God's in full control. Okay? There'll always be another deal. God's in control. If God wanted me to have this truck, that truck, could God have held it for me? Yes. Of course he could have. The very next day, my landlord calls me because he knew I was looking for a truck because I had talked to him about it. He goes, I was going to sell you my truck if you want to buy it. So let's talk about it. Come to my office. He goes, I'm going to sell you this truck for $20,000. That other truck was a 2007 gas truck. This one's a 2013 diesel. Chevy Duramax, 3/4 ton. 106,000 miles. For a diesel, that's just warming up. This truck is worth over $30,000. He goes, I'll sell it to you for $20,000, and you can just do some dental work for me. I was like, God, you're amazing. The day afterwards, well, we picked up the truck. It was an awesome truck, but I didn't need it after a while. We sold it. We sold it for a good chunk of money. I'm like, God, you're amazing. That's the kind of God that we serve. I could tell you a story. I'm going to share this with the young kids. I don't normally share all these stories. My daughter wanted a job, her first job at 15. She applied at Baskin-Robbins, and they're not even calling her. And she's so disappointed. I'm like, why would they call you? You got no experience. If I was the owner of Baskin-Robbins, I'm going to hire someone who's 17 or 18 years old. She's so bummed. And then Teaspoon opened up. For you guys to know what Teaspoon is, it's a chain. It's a bubble tea shop. It's a bubble tea place. Okay, they sell fancy drinks. And my daughter now wanted to work there, so she applied. They called her for an interview, and the owner liked my daughter. She got a job there. She was so excited. And I had to remind her, aren't you thankful you didn't get the job there? God always has something better in store. But you know what? We, in our little minds, we think this is what we know. This is what we want. If you learn to trust God, he will always have something better in store for you. The way we respond to trials when we go through the fire is our witness. Why would the world want to trust us as Christians if we're complaining like everyone else is? Because complaining is in vogue today. Everybody is complaining. So I want you to remember that. Praise and thanksgiving is like tithing. If you learn to give praise and thanks when it's easy, like when mom gives you food, you say, thank you, mom, so much for the little things. Tell your teachers, thank you so much for teaching the class. If you get used to that when it's easy, then when the big trials come, it won't be difficult. Just like tithing. You got to learn to tithe when you're not making very much money, when you only have to pay $10 in tithe. What happens when you sell your first home and your tithing check can be $10,000, $30,000, $50,000? People struggle. I sold a business, and it was a big check. I wrote the check out, and I was thankful that it wasn't difficult for me to turn that tithe in, because I'm not paying God. I'm returning it to God, right? I don't want to struggle with that. If you struggle with the little things, you will struggle with the big things. Remember what we learned last night? Success in this life, success in gaining the future life depends upon a faithful, conscientious attention to the little things. I'm going to mention this because tithing is a topic that I love talking about. Because so many people lose the blessings of God when it comes to tithing. You know, whenever tithing comes up and the pastor speaks about tithing, someone in the audience almost invariably asks this question. Do you have to tithe on the net or on the gross? You know what they're asking? What's the least amount I can return tithe on and still get God's blessings? And the pastor always gives this answer, and I thought it was the worst answer. It's between you and the Lord. I thought that was a weak answer. But you know what? I realized the pastor is right. My understanding was so small. The pastor is right. It really depends on you whether you want to pay on the net or the gross. Do you want the net blessings or do you want the gross blessings from God? Totally up to you. Because I want the gross blessings. Because you can't outgive God. You and I are spiritual Israel. We are on the borders of the Jordan River. We are about to go into the promised land. What was it that kept the Israelites from going to the promised land? It was murmuring and complaining. And you know what? We're doing the exact same thing today. And we're also missing out on the blessings. Can you think of the most quintessential story in the New Testament about praising God? Paul and Silas. They are faithfully serving God. If anyone had an excuse to murmur and complain while they're locked up in prison with their feet in stocks and they're singing hymns and praising God, and what happens? God sends a mighty earthquake. Prison doors are flung open. And now the jailer asks, what must I do to be for me and my household to be saved? So I want to challenge you in everything. Even though you cannot see the future, learn to praise and thank God. If you'll bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to praise you because you are the beginning and the end. We praise you because you're in control of all things. We thank you for your rich blessings in our life. Help us, Lord, not to lose the blessings you have in store for us by murmuring and complaining. We thank you and we love you. To you be all praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.